So this is a beautiful text that we have in Scripture. It's a continuation, as John was telling us, of what we heard last week. This is kind of part two, and there's a lot going on in these verses. But think about this. What if Jesus added you on Facebook? Can you imagine what kind of posts and pictures Jesus would like? But I think even more profound, which ones would Jesus not like? Which one would he might put that little angry face instead of a like? And there might be more of those than we think. And some people take offense to this idea of Buddy Jesus that was popularized by the movie Dogma. It's a great movie if you haven't seen it, but it can borderline on being offensive. But I think in a good way. To some extent, I can understand this sentiment because we proclaim Jesus as Lord and friend. That just seems to be too dang personal for the God of the cosmos, right? Yet here we have Jesus saying in Scripture that the disciples are his friends. And we have these beautiful hymns. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. So there's something there. If we are followers of Jesus, this means we also have been friended by Christ. Once again, Jesus stresses his love and desire to be in intimate relationship with those that live and abide in his word. So how do we maintain a friendship with Jesus? Just do what he says, love. That's easy enough, right? God is calling each and every one of us to love. So I've been reading this book lately, and I'm falling in love. It's written by this Irish guy, Peter Rowlands, and it's best if you listen to it because he's got a beautiful Irish accent. And I won't try to humor you with an Irish accent this morning. I don't want to take away from his story. But he illustrates this idea of love and friendship in his tale about a woman who becomes friends with God. Her name is Sophia, and she has a dream where God speaks to her as a friend, as an intimate companion. And God asks her to translate the scripture into plain language. Now, Sophia lives in a small, poor village around the time of when the printing press had just been invented. And she's excited to serve as God has asked that she leave for the big city to beg and do odd jobs in order to pay for a printing press, a place to house the press, and scholars that can translate the Bible from Hebrew and Greek into her common language instead of Latin, because those were the only Bibles that existed for most people in that day. They were written in Latin, and they were locked up in the churches where only the most educated had access. Painstakingly, she gathers the money for years and almost has earned enough when a flood devastates a nearby village. Moved by compassion, she feels she must help these families who have now lost everything. So she takes the money she has collected and uses it to help them. The people are grateful for her compassion and generosity. Once again, feeling God's call to her for service, she continues her task and work of begging for money in order to translate the Bible. Years pass before she's able to recuperate the funds and save up what she needs for translating the Bible. About the time she gets back up to the place where she was before, the city is hit with an awful plague. People become very sick and many die. She decides that she must use her money to buy medicine for the poor and land for people to safely bury their loved ones. Once again, she uses all her money to help people who are in crisis. And so she has to start over with her call to translate the Bible as Jesus has come to her and asked. Knowing that God has chosen her for this special task, she once again works and begs in the city in order to raise money to do this incredible service. Now at this point, Sophia is much older than before. She is limited in the odd jobs that she's able to do. Yet people have now heard of her kindness and generosity. So even those who are poor give her as much as they can. She finally raises the money and starts to become very ill. Sophia at last buys the printing press and a house to shop, to house it in, a place to house it in. Then she begins to pay the scholars in order to translate it. And she lives just long enough to see the first batch of Bibles completed, and there's enough money left over to make a few more batches that will be made after she dies. Friends, this is a moving and beautiful story of a woman who was chosen and befriended by God. And she desperately wants to fulfill the request that Jesus has made of her to translate the Holy Scripture into plain language. And she feels like she was barely able to accomplish it. She worried throughout her life that she was letting God down. And the truth is that she translated the Word of God not once, but three times. And the first two were more beautiful and transforming to the people than the last. Likewise, Jesus has chosen us to be friends who take the Word of God into flesh. That is, we live out the words of Scripture that can be summarized by Jesus' incredible love. So in this passage, it sounds a bit unnerving that Christ says, "If you follow my commandment, you will be my friends." That does not sound like much of a friendship. We can be friends so long as you do what I want. Right? That doesn't sound very good. But Jesus does this because his command is to love. By reciprocating the love back to the Father and paying that same love forward to the other children of God, the relationship is made meaningful. Without love, there can be no friendship. There can be no close and intimate relationship. So although it's stated as a command, there can be no loving friendship without us loving God and loving each other. God has chosen each and every one of us by love and for love. The Spirit dwells within us so that we can love in ways that would probably seem impossible to others. Showing loving kindness to others puts the Word of Jesus into the flesh, allows us to be the hands and feet of Jesus in a broken world in need of healing. Friends, in other words, we participate in the incarnation of God in the here and now. As followers of Jesus, we are asked to translate the book of love by our actions and words in our daily lives. Do you love God? Do you want to be friends with Jesus? Well, get out there and do it. The Scripture states it in a variety of ways that we are to be people of compassion. This is throughout the Old Testament and the New, from Genesis to Revelation. Are we willing to put aside our dreams and our calling to bless others with radical love? In so doing, we might just more fully complete what God has called us for. After all, Sophia dedicated her life to being God's friend. She listened and obeyed. Even when she thought she was failing and falling behind on her calling, she was, in reality, translating the Bible into the language of the heart. Anyone who has ever been in a friendship or other loving relationship knows that you must give of yourself. And that giving is not always reciprocated. Sometimes one friend or one loved one is giving more than another. You have to sacrifice your time and your resources for the love to be true, not expecting anything in return. And as humans, that's hard for us to accept. But think about the amount of time and money that parents pour into their children. Are we willing to dedicate ourselves to a loving relationship with the Lord that pours out at least that much time, energy, and resources as we would do for our own kids? Jesus is my friend. Christ can be your buddy. And Jesus Christ is also still Savior and Lord. So that is what compels us to uphold our end of the bargain, to maintain that covenant relationship of love day in and day out. And we can never do it perfectly. We are sinful human beings. But by the grace of God, we have been filled with spirits of love. Acts of loving kindness do not save us or earn us a spot in heaven. Our response to God's unconditional love is to love one another. This includes hearing God's call for our lives and living into that very call so that we can grow closer to Christ every day and in every way. Abiding with God, living in God, is all about relationship. Loving relationship that we can describe as a friendship. So the good news is that Jesus has indeed befriended each and every one of us and chosen us to keep spreading the love. Friends, this is both a simple and daunting task.